7:01, and we will call the meeting to order. I will ask that everyone please stand for the playing of O Canada. Item 3 on the agenda, roll call of councillors. Turn the mic over to CAO.
Richmond County Municipal Council regular meeting, March 25th, 2019. Roll call of members of council. Councillor James Goyage.
Present.
Councillor Alvin Martel.
Present.
Deputy Warden Brian Marchand.
Councillor
Gilbert Boucher.
Present.
Warden Jason McLean.
Present.
All accounted for.
Thank you. Item 4 on the agenda, we have had 3 items previously added. There is to be some discussion on EDPC costs, discussion on the Regional Enterprise Network, and a question with regards to the 2018-2019 sundry budget account. Are there any other items to be added to the agenda with unanimous consent? Deputy?
Thank you, Warden. I'd like to add some discussion on the St. Peter's Trail, and the trail I'm referring to is this railway bed that seems to be a contentious issue with many people. I'd like to have a little bit of discussion on that if council allows.
Any issues? Councillor Goyesh, issues with that? You're good, Gilbert? Yeah. Okay. Any other items to be added to the agenda with unanimous consent?
Move to accept the agenda with the items added.
It's been moved by the deputy that we accept the agenda with items added. Do I have a seconder?
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Boucher. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Motion carried, and we'll also ask for acceptance of the agenda itself.
Well, that's what I said, the agenda with the items added.
Oh, okay, sorry, I thought you just meant the items added. Okay, very good. Okay, so on to item 4A. Deputy, I will turn the mic over to you.
Well, that's under items added.
Oh, sorry, at the end. Okay, review of minutes. So in your package, we would have had the review of the minutes from the February 25th, 2019 regular council. And I will look for adoption of the minutes.
I'll move.
It's been moved by Councillor Goyesh, the adoption of the minutes from the February 25th, 2019 regular council meeting. Can I have a seconder?
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Martel. Points of discussion?
Questions
called on the motion. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Motion carried. Presentation. So we do have us. Mr. Darrell McMullen, please approach the back. Okay.
Good evening, everybody. As Jason said, my name is Darrell McMullen. I'm the district commander for Richmond County RCMP. and I'd like to thank you for the invite tonight to come here to present the quarterly report. I'll give a brief overview of what's happening in Richmond County District with the RCMP, and I'll present to you some stats that will range from January to March 2019. So our annual performance plan, the priorities that we have set for Richmond County District encapsulate three main priorities. They are to enhance relationship with Indigenous communities, enhancing road safety, which incorporates impaired investigations, check stops, and Highway Traffic Act enforcement. And third is reducing crimes against persons. This includes person and property crimes, crime reduction initiatives, and cybercrime. This plan will be going forward again in the 2019 fiscal. This is a two-year plan with the RCMP in Nova Scotia to include these main priorities throughout the communities, and within these three priorities, with improving relationships with Indigenous communities, enhancing road safety, and reducing crimes against persons, we set individual initiatives within those three priorities to try to balance and achieve those goals. Over the course of the last 3 months, these stats will have ranged from January to the beginning of March. So in total, from January to March 2019, the Richmond County District RCMP responded to a total of 423 calls for service. These numbers are also reflective of self-generated calls for service, which includes proactive traffic enforcement. So 274 of the 423 calls included traffic enforcement. So you break that down, you're looking at roughly 150 calls for service that were generated. During these months, members have completed 25 check stops throughout the county, checking over 900 vehicles, 917 to be exact. There were five related charges of impaired driving by either drugs, alcohol, or refusals, which also included two roadside suspensions where there were no grounds to lay a charge. There were 15 collisions reported with one fatality. There were 127 summary offense tickets issued under the various provincial acts. They include the Highway Traffic Act, Liquor Control Act, Cannabis Control Act, and Off-Highway Vehicle Act, with 134 warnings issued along with 13 defect notices. I'll give you a breakdown of some of the common offenses where summary offense tickets were issued, but they are not limited to the following. So these basically are the main infractions that we deal with on a regular basis. There was one distracted driving cell phone SOT issued, 18 speeding tickets issued between 1 and 15 kilometers, 24 related speed infractions between 16 and 30 kilometers, and there was one speeding ticket over 31 kilometers per hour over the posted speed limit. I believe this was the one where a stunting charge was laid. One of the officers, I believe if you read in the media, this was a LIDAR enforcement in Irish Cove, and the motorist was doing 146 and a posted 80 speed limit. There were three summary offense tickets for no seatbelt, four for no driver's license, six no insurance, three no registration, and three driving while revoked or suspended. I'll give you a human resource update within Richmond County for all who may not be aware. Richmond County District RCMP includes 11 members. Within that structure, there's two detachment assistants. We have a detachment assistant in Aerschatz, a detachment assistant in St. Peter's, one sergeant, two corporals, and eight constables. At the present moment, we currently have three vacancies within the district. That is the corporal vacancy in St. Peter's is considered a hard vacancy, which means it's vacant. The corporal has since left and promoted to a different location, and we're currently trying to fill that position now through either the promotion process, or there's a potential lateral candidate who's a corporal in Alberta who we may, I'll learn more about over the next week or two if they're able to come to St. Peter's. And we have two soft vacancies at the constable level. Soft meaning they're off for medical reasons, so we can't backfill those positions until they're off the books. So out of the 11 members, we have three off the books, and we're currently in the process of trying to get the two that are off back to work and that corporal position filled. So St. Peter's will consist of the sergeant, a corporal, four constables. Baladec consists of two constables. One of those constables who's a soft vacancy is actually retiring in June of 2019. Aerostat consists of a corporal and two constables. They're fully staffed at the moment. And a highlight here, our detachment assistant there in Aerostat, Natalie Sampson, has submitted her paperwork. She's retiring after 34 years of service with the RCMP. We're going to have a celebration for Natalie in the very near future, and we currently have her position advertised now. It was effective last week with a 40-kilometer radius within Richmond County, bilingual priority, and that job action will close, I believe, April 11th. So that will be a great position for somebody over in this area in the 40-kilometer radius to be able to seek that position. Our fleet updates. Richmond County is compromised of six vehicles within the district. So we have two that remain in Aerostat, and we have four on the St. Peter's side between Chapel Island and St. Peter's. Those vehicles are compromised. We have a 4x4 Tahoe, Ford Explorer, and four Tauruses. The Explorer and Tahoe that we have has been issued within the last year, and we're just waiting for another new Ford Explorer to be replaced this spring for one of the four Taurus vehicles. And we have two brand new ATVs that we received this past summer, Polaris ATVs, and they're a great addition. So getting into the hard statistics there for criminal code offenses. I'm just going to go down through the chart here. So again, from the period from January to March 2019, we had six reports of assault, four break and enters to residence and or business, two theft of motor vehicle, six theft under 5,000, one theft over 5,000, zero for drug possession, one for drug trafficking, six Liquor Act, three Cannabis Control Act, four for causing a disturbance and or mischief, which includes public intoxication, eight reports of impaired driving, six reports of sex assault, four Coroner's Act investigations, nine reports of breach of probation or court orders, 12 uttering threats, seven 911 Act, 70 would be other miscellaneous offenses. For total violations, as I stated previously, when you subtract the self-generated traffic, 149 calls for service. Actual calls for service, 423, including the self-generated traffic. And the prisoners, I have one. I think that may be skewed. It was possibly three. All our prisoners go to Port Hawkesbury, so at the very least, it was very minimal. Subject to any other questions, that will be my report prior to. As everybody is aware, this is Fraud Prevention Month, and I'd just like to have a little shout-out there that myself and Richmond County Seniors Safety Coordinator Michelle McPhee will be completing a fraud presentation in Lewisdale at the Parish Hall on March 27th at 10 a.m. So anybody who's looking, who has been a victim of fraud or is interested in gaining further insight and knowledge into that area, I encourage you to come and hear a presentation between myself and Michelle.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Sergeant McMullen. Any questions for Daryl? Okay, Councilor Goyash.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to, what are defect notices? I know you got that listed there. What does that mean, actually?
So a defect notice is essentially, it's a notice given to a motorist to remedy an infraction within a specified time frame.
i.e. could be tinted windows or a muffler that may be loud. So in lieu of writing an actual ticket or a warning, a defect notice will be issued to state that whatever issue it is with your vehicle, we're giving you a week to 2 weeks to have that rectified. Come back to the office, show us that it has been fixed, and it ends there, essentially. Okay. It's almost like a lesser of a warning.
Does that include a warning? Is it the same thing as you have no license available at the time, no insurance?
No.
No registration? Do you have a time limit whereby one day I can go to you and prove that I have these? It just happens that I didn't have it in the vehicle at that time. I know the law says you need to have it.
Yeah, and the Highway Traffic Act is very broad with respect to offenses and what you can issue tickets for. But we have systems in place with respect to a driver's license that we can tell if somebody has a license. Insurance, sometimes people can return and show that they had valid insurance at the time of the stop. And if that's the case, we can void the ticket.
Okay. I have more questions if somebody else has any.
Anybody else have a question?
I have questions. Okay, I see human resources update that right now there is three vacancies. Now, maybe you can't answer this, but how does this reflect on the total cost that Richmond County has to pay? We pay, I think, $1.5 million for police servicing for 11 members. So when there's three vacancies, does that reflect a drop in our amount of money we have to pay for police servicing, or is that a set amount that we pay at 1.5 and regardless how much? I think it's based on...
I could be wrong on this, but I do believe that it operates as it does with education, where the money actually goes to the province, and then, or in this case, maybe the feds, and then it gets dispersed from there.
Yeah, so to answer your question to the best of my ability, under the Provincial Policing Service Act contract between the municipality and the RCMP, it would be a 70-30 split between the municipality of Richmond and the federal government. So Richmond County would pay 70%, and the federal government would pay 30%. With these vacancies, which occur straight across the board in Canada, with people, members that go off due to maternity leave, paternity leave, to my knowledge, it doesn't affect that you would pay any less amount. It's just the nature and reality of vacancies and the policing structure where we have gaps and shortages. And so with those two soft positions, it's basically out of our control. They don't necessarily backfill the position. So basically what we do is we have to fill those shifts with overtime. To my knowledge, that doesn't get incurred to the municipality. You just pay your set 70%.
So you're telling me the coverage is still there, regardless if you're missing
coverage,
three, we still have the total?
Absolutely. The policing coverage has got to be there, and that is maintained.
Okay. Now, I guess the famous question I have as a councillor locally, and it's been a famous question, can an RCMP speed or drive in excess of speed limit on any given occasion? Is that something that's allowed? I know the ambulances are restricted. They cannot speed. Fire departments cannot. Can an RCMP officer drive downtown Ayrshire at an excess speed?
No. There's situations and circumstances that dictate a priority response based on a call for service. There are a variety of different calls for service which would warrant a more expedient response. So during those times, lights and sirens should be activated. And at the end of the day, you still have to drive prudently and reasonable, because we're still accountable for our actions if there were to be a collision occur en route to a call for service. So you still have to take into account time of day, where you're at, are you in a school zone? So the onus still lies with the member to drive responsibly, because if they're not able to get to that call for service in a safe manner, we can't help the people that need help.
Yeah.
So my response to your question would be, if there are any issues with respect to members and driving recklessly or dangerously throughout any community. I encourage anybody to come forward and speak to me. We have a public complaint process. We have a civilian review complaints commission in Ottawa, and that allows for members of the public to make complaints against the RCMP, and the matter can be investigated. Aside from that, I have an open door. Anybody can come see me at any time, and I can look into the matter and allay any concerns if there are from any councillors or residents within Richmond County.
Because it definitely did happen, and I witnessed it myself in the school zone in Irishside.
Yeah.
And they were going over at least 80 kilometers an hour in a school zone. And
so
I can't tell you who was driving because I couldn't see it.
Yeah.
We're going too fast. But I think the community, the whole basis of this is that I've been around for 45 years, I guess. And to me, an RCMP constable has to work, especially in a rural community. And it seems to be that everybody that's trained, they send them to a rural area. I guess we're the training station. And my feeling about protection, everybody wants to be protected by the RCMP, and they're well respected. But the thing is, I think they have to work with the community, with organizations, be visible, definitely. But I don't think they're there to try to catch anybody. I think you're there to protect the public, make them aware that you are present and visible, and work with community groups and organizations. And I think that's very important. In that way, you gain more respect from the residents of Richmond County on the dam, and at the same time, it's a mutual respect that you gain between the two parties. And I think that's something that should be enforced and instilled into any police force that we do have, that the community is only a rural community and we have to work together. I think that's very important. But thank you very much for your presentation. The information is very important, and I think it's appropriate that we get a report quarterly from the detachment, and I thank you very much for your report.
Any further questions or comments for Sergeant? Okay. Great. Thanks very much, Daryl.
Yep. No problem. Thank you.
We appreciate your time. We know you're a busy guy, and I know we've had a few conversations to try to get you down here, so we really appreciate you taking some time to come down and update us. So thanks so much. Item 7 on the agenda, we do have, under committee reports, we do have a Heritage Advisory Committee report. We'll turn the floor over to Deputy Warden.
Thank you, Warden. Heritage Advisory Committee report for the month of March 2019. The committee has met once since the last council meeting. The committee reviewed the application from the Whiteside Church Preservation Society and received permission from the property owner, the Diocese of Antigonish, regarding the application for heritage status for the property commonly known as St. Patrick's Church at 1621 Whiteside Road, Richmond County, Nova Scotia, PID number 75033100. I move that Council accept the recommendation of the Heritage Advisory Committee and that notice of registration of this property, PID 75033100, be placed on the Municipal Registry of Heritage Property, and notice of such registration shall be sent to the Diocese of Antigonish and to the Whiteside Church Preservation Society, and that a copy of the registration shall be deposited in the Registry of Deeds for the district in which the municipal heritage property is located.
It's been moved by Deputy Warden Marchand that Council accept the recommendation of the Heritage Advisory Committee and that notice of registration of property PID 75033100 be placed on the Municipal Registry of Heritage Property, and notice of such registration shall be sent to the Diocese of Antigonish and to the Whiteside Church Preservation Society, and that a copy of the registration shall be deposited in the Registry of Deeds for the district in which the Municipal Heritage Property is located. Do I have a seconder?
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Martel. Any discussion?
Question.
Questions called on the motion. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Deputy.
Thank you, Warden. This concludes the monthly report of the Heritage Advisory Committee for the month of March 2019, and I move its adoption.
It's been moved by Deputy Warden Marshaw that we accept the report from the Heritage Advisory Committee. Do I have a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion? Questions called on the motion. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Item 7B on the agenda. I'm not sure if there is anyone here to an opportunity for the property owner of the Diocese of Antigonish to speak before council. If so, please approach council at the back. Okay. All right. Moving on to item 8 on the agenda. Item 8 is a second reading approval, and in your package you would have had attached an Appendix A. So the second reading for the approval is to adopt bylaw number 65, the noise bylaw, as a bylaw of the municipality of the County of Richmond.
So moved.
Moved by Councillor Gayesh for second reading approval of the to adopt bylaw 65.
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Martel. Discussion on the motion? Questions called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Item 9 on the agenda, second reading approval. You would have received in your package Appendix B, and this is to repeal, second reading to repeal bylaw number 8, mischiefs and nuisances bylaw, which will be replaced by bylaw number 65, the noise bylaw.
Move to second reading.
Moved by Councillor Boucher that we accept the second reading approval for bylaw to repeal bylaw number 8. And replaced by mischiefs and nuisances bylaw 65. I have a seconder.
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Martel. Any discussion on the motion? Questions called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Item 10 is second reading approval. I will turn the floor over to Councillor Martel.
I move to amend bylaw.
Can you get your, sorry, Alvin, can you get your mic there?
I move to amend bylaw number 56 to include the Rocky Bay Ballfield, AAN number 10587255, council meeting to amend bylaw 56, tax exemption.
So it's been moved by Councillor Martel to amend bylaw number 56 to include the Rocky Bay Ballfield, AAN number 10587255. Look for a seconder.
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Boucher. Any discussion on the motion?
Question.
Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Okay, motion carried. Item 11 on the agenda is a first reading approval. I will hand the floor now over to Deputy Warden Marshall.
Thank you, Warden. First reading approval to amend bylaw 56, the tax exemption bylaw, in order to cap the current assessment account numbers included and not consider any new applicant requests for exemptions other than those currently pending. It's attached as Appendix C, version number 4.
It's been moved by Deputy Warden Marshaw for first reading approval to amend bylaw number 56, tax exemption bylaw, in order to cap the current assessment account numbers included and not consider any new applicant requests for exemptions other than those currently pending. Seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion on the motion? Questions been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Another first reading approval from Councillor Martel.
First reading notice to amend bylaw number 56 in order to include the property account number 0541047, piece of land located between the Kalbopor and the soccer field.
So it's been moved by Councillor Martel, first reading approval to amend bylaw number 56 in order to include property account number 0541047, which is a piece of land located between the Kalbopor and the soccer field. Attached as Appendix E in your package. Do I have a seconder?
Second.
Seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion on the motion?
Question.
Questions called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Okay. Item 13. It's just a, we do have a note here from the Epilepsy Association of Nova Scotia regarding Purple Day, and we do have a proclamation that I will get to, but I just want to read a little bit of background information from this group. So the Epilepsy Association of Nova Scotia is reaching out to all maritime provinces to support Purple Day, which is March 26th, tomorrow. This is Purple Day's 11th anniversary, and we hope that all municipalities, towns, and cities participate. Purple Day was founded by Cassidy Megan, an 8-year-old girl who wanted one day in every year for everyone to learn about epilepsy and support those who live with this neurological condition. On June 28, 2012, the Government of Canada created the Purple Day Act and received royal assent. March 26th is officially recognized as Purple Day in Canada. Working with Cassidy Megan, our organization approached the Anita Kaufman Foundation in the U.S. to make Purple Day a global initiative, and we succeeded. It is recognized in over 85 countries and on every continent. And that's not a continent. That is not the complete letter, but there is some additional information there with regards to that. And I will now read the proclamation. And after reading the proclamation, there was an ask that we do take a picture of council with our purple ribbons on and send that. So we'll take a quick moment to snap a photo. Proclamation, Purple Day of Epilepsy Proclamation, March 26, 2019. Whereas Purple Day is a global effort dedicated to promoting epilepsy awareness in countries around the world, and whereas Purple Day was founded in 2008 by Cassidy Megan, a 9-year-old girl from Nova Scotia who wanted people to know that if you have epilepsy, you are not alone, and whereas epilepsy is one of the most common neurological conditions estimated to affect more than 50 million people worldwide, and more than 300,000 people in Canada, and whereas the public is often unable to recognize the common seizure types or how to respond with appropriate first aid, and whereas Purple Day will be celebrated on March 26th annually to increase understanding, reduce stigma, and improve the quality of life for people with epilepsy throughout the country and globally, I therefore proclaim March 26, 2019, Purple Day in Nova Scotia in an effort to raise epilepsy awareness everywhere. Dated at Aerochat, Nova Scotia, this 25th day of March, 2019. Can I ask Council just to come up to the back here? So on that note, I would certainly encourage everyone that tomorrow is the official day. I would like to encourage everyone to sport their purple colors tomorrow. Item 13B on the agenda. We do have a few grant requests. I will turn the floor over to our Director of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Warden. In your package, Council, you have three grant requests. The first grant request is a request from the River Bourgeois Mariner Society, and that's for a Type 1 grant, infrastructure grant, in the amount of $4,676.26. This is an application to upgrade the docks and the facilities at their site. More specifically, they are looking to shore up their 50-foot walkway, which is currently eroding due to surge tides. They will do this by pouring extra strong salt water resistant concrete. They are also looking to do future work and other projects which involve mandatory repairs welding of the main docks, as well as lifting, sandblasting, and repainting of the main docks. The group made note that in their financial statements they have approximately $20,000 in their savings account, and they wanted to note that these funds have been raised over a number of years past in anticipation of these large, expensive upcoming projects. The group has provided the required information, and the application appears complete.
Moved by Councilor Boucher that we accept the grant request, infrastructure grant request, in the amount of $4,676.25 to the River Bourgeois Mariners Society. Do I have a seconder?
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Martel. Discussion on the motion. Okay, Deputy.
I see the grant request was for $5,000, yet they're getting $4,600. Is that to do with a HST?
Yeah.
Okay, so all of these are able to claim portion
back.
Yeah,
so I think when groups are applying, they don't realize that they're just applying for the $5,000 because it's the max. But half the HST gets backed out, so basically I'm just taking that into consideration.
And you verified that they do get that HST back?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Warden.
Okay.
Question?
Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Warden. The second grant in your package is a grant request for a Type 1 infrastructure grant for the Furshoe Development Association. And this one's in the amount of $4,973.75. As you all know, 50% funding. It's an application to replace the flooring in the main hall, kitchen, and stage area. The flooring is the original flooring and is worn out. Replacing it will ease the maintenance that is done by aging volunteers, as well as enhance the renovations completed in 2018. The group has provided the required information, and the application appears complete.
For a motion from the floor.
We approve the Furshoe Development Association infrastructure grant to $4,973.75.
It's been moved by Councillor Boucher that the Type 1 infrastructure grant in the amount of $4,973.75 for the Furshoe Development Association. Do I have a seconder?
I'll second it.
Seconded by Deputy Warden. Any discussion on the motion?
Question.
Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Director.
Thank you, Mr. Warden. The third grant in your council package is a grant request for a Type 1 infrastructure grant for the Bonnie Bray Senior Citizen Club in the amount of $4,932.75, again at 50% funding. It's an application to replace the floor in the main hall entry washroom, and also to replace two windows and to rebuild the steps going into the basement. The present vinyl floor is over 20 years old, and some of the tiles are starting to lift. The windows are older wooden frames, and some of them are rotting to the point where they can't be opened any longer. The group has provided the required information, and the application appears complete.
Look for a motion on the from the floor.
I move to accept the Bonnie Bray Senior Citizen $4,932.75.
It's been moved by Councillor Boucher that we accept the Type 1 Infrastructure Grant Fund request in the amount of $4,932.75 for the Bonnie Bray Senior Citizens Club, seconded by Deputy Warden Marchand. Any question on the discussion on the motion?
Question.
Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Okay, back to items added. First item added to the agenda is a discussion on the EDPD costs. So I'll turn the floor over to the Deputy Warden.
Thank you, Warden. Warden, in light of our loss of revenue due to some assessment loss and our increased costs this year, I think it's prudent upon Council to start looking at ways that we can potentially find some savings, and I believe this is one. So I'm prepared to make a motion that we give EDPC our 1 year notice for leaving the commission.
Second.
It's been moved by Deputy Warden that we give our 1 year notice to EDPC and seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion?
Under discussion, I think this is a advance of what we intend to do. I'd rather have staff provide a cost analysis, because if you remember, I think we have municipal units that have joined the EDPC. And the reason they have done that, they have found out that it's they don't have the resources themselves that EDPC have, and they decided to go with the Eastern District Planning Commission instead of having their own. So I think the appropriate measure for me would be to get staff to do a cost evaluation, but not serve notice. I think we can do a cost analysis of what it would cost the council to have our own as compared to engaging with the Eastern District Planning Commission. But I don't think we should go as far as saying 1 year notice. I think we need more information, and I find this going ahead of the game. Why don't we get staff just do a cost analysis and not have a timeline based on it? I will not support the motion with 1 year notice, but to get staff to do a cost analysis, yes, I agree with that.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Martel?
Yeah, I certainly agree with the mover and the seconder, and the reason being is that I agree with Councilor Goyesh. I mean, there needs to be some information, but I think that in light of what's happening here with the budgets and what we're faced with, is that it's prudent to give notice, and it doesn't mean that in a year from now that we have to leave EDPC. Once we have the information, we can make an informed decision. We'll have a year to decide, and I don't think it's going to, you know, to make sure that we don't miss the deadline. And if everything is good, we had a report in 2016, I'm aware of, and it showed that EDPC was more feasible than doing it ourselves, but that's 7 years ago. And I think that right now, I think it's prudent to do what we're doing. Thank you.
Okay. Question.
Just prior to question, I will say that obviously this is an intermunicipal agreement, which kind of adds some complexities to this whole thing. So, you know, I get the point too, where, you know, we're going to be in some tough times with regards to budget, but at the same time, there's a level of service that's expected by our residents. So it's something to just keep in the backs of our mind for sure. Question's been called on the motion. All those in favor, by giving EDPC 1 year's notice, raise your right hand. Opposed? Motion carried. Item four.
I'd like to remain on this one. I had two outcomes. My next outcome is to have a motion that we have staff look at various other options and come back to us with that. So I make a motion that we have staff do that. And I think it was better to do it in this way, because if we spend 6 months looking at it, we have to wait till next year to give them notice. So giving notice first was my intent, and then this motion is to have staff look at our options. We can't just sit around and wait till a year. We have to either prepare for what we're going to be doing in a year, so we need to have staff look at setting up. Correct.
The motion is already passed.
There's. I am not discussing the motion. I'm making another motion.
No, this is a different another motion.
But it's not a motion. State to it. That's another motion.
That's exactly what I said. I'm making a motion. Yes. To give the 1 year notice and. Have staff provide a cost analysis of remaining in or doing it on our own. And I believe they should be two separate motions.
I must have got the wrong information on my agenda.
That's not on your agenda, I think.
Okay, so your motion.
My next
is
motion is to have staff look at either presenting us with doing this on our own and costing that, as well as remaining in the EDPC. So we just want to prepare before. We don't want to be waiting till next March to decide what we're going to do. So my motion is to have staff look at our options.
Okay, so it's been moved by Deputy Warden to have staff look at our options with regards to potentially not being a part of EDPC. Is that fair to say?
Correct.
Okay. Seconder? Seconded by Councilor Martel. Discussion? Questions called on the motion. All those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Opposed? Motion carried. So item, next item on the agenda is an item added, and that is the topic of the Regional Enterprise Network. I'll turn the floor over to Deputy Warden.
Thank you, Warden. Again, with our current fiscal situation, which is not looking good, this is another area where I believe we can find some cost savings. So I want to make a motion that we give the Cape Breton Partnership and the Cape Breton Wren our one-year notice of leaving the Wren.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved by Deputy Warden that we give one-year notice to the Wren, seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion on the motion? Sorry, yeah, Councillor Goyesh?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Again, I would like to make a motion on this one to table this motion. And my reasoning for this is until we get more information, I think we have the CAO from the Wren prepared to come before council, and I think it's in the month of, I'm not too sure, is it the month of April?
The CEO from the Cape Breton Partnership is scheduled to be here to do a presentation
to
for
do
our
a presentation.
April of the Committee of the Whole, yes.
With this kind of motion, I haven't got the information that I need. I need way more information, and I think with the CEO being present, making a presentation to council, this will give us the information so that we can make a sound judgment call or decide where we're going. Right now, I don't have the information to make a decision either way. And I think we owe it to the Wren to afford them the opportunity to come before council and discuss with us the situation with Wren as it pertains to Richmond Council. Thank you. So okay. I make a motion to table.
It's been moved to table the motion. Do I have a seconder to table the motion? No seconder to table the motion? Okay.
You'll have to vote in the motion now.
Pardon me?
You'll have to vote in the motion now.
Vote on the motion, yeah. So that's the tabling part is defeated, and we will now vote on the motion. So all those in favor of providing the...
No, I want to just ask something. I was unaware that the Cape Breton Partnership was coming. Where did you hear that, Councillor Goyesh?
Huh?
Where did you hear the partnership was coming to make a presentation? I wasn't made aware of that.
Oh, sorry. I'm involved in municipal council, sorry.
Okay.
You must be the only one because I never heard.
Well, if you never heard, it's not my fault.
No, well, I do know that the Cape Breton Partnership has been booked to come down for a little bit of time, but that was only in April, so.
Okay.
Was that signed out to all the councils?
Not yet, no. Okay, question on the motion. All those in favor of providing the Regional Enterprise Network with 1 year's notice, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? Motion carried. Next item on the agenda is looking for some information with regards to the 2018-2019 sundry budget account. It was submitted by Councillor Martel.
On Monday, March 11, 2019, at the meeting, a question arose about the sundry account. Later that evening, Councilor Marchand made a request for a copy of the 2018-2019 sundry account. To date, 10 working days later, Councilor Marchand has not received that information. So apparently, CAO is not responding to one councilor's request for information. Therefore, I took it upon myself to bring it to council for a vote of council. If the motion is accepted, hopefully CAO can feel comfortable releasing that information. I move that council direct the CAO to instruct the CFO to print and distribute a computer-generated copy of the 2018-2019 sundry budget account to all councilors immediately following this meeting.
It's been moved by Councillor Martel that the CAO instruct the CFO to print the 2018-2019, print and distribute the 2018-2019 sundry budget account.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I can give that to Yvonne if you want it.
Seconder?
Seconded.
Seconded by Councillor Boucher. On discussion?
Can we amend that, Councillor Martel? And the amendment I'd like to make to that is I don't want to wait till after the meeting. I don't know how long this will take. I would like the CFO directed to do it currently. So the motion's passed. So can we make that amendment, not just after the meeting?
Yep. Fine with me.
Okay, you're okay with that?
Yep.
Okay. Question?
On discussion, I'd like to.
Okay.
Discussion. Yeah, and the reason I'm asking for this information is that right now, as you know, we're in the middle of budget, and I think it would be very informative to have that kind of information to decide on the 2019-2020 budget. Thank you.
So am I correct in saying that you want that to happen immediately?
Immediately. I don't know how long this takes. It's been 14 days and I haven't seen it, so I assume it takes some time. So I think CFO is here. If the CAO is okay with that, maybe he can start on that.
So while that's happening, are you suggesting that we have to wait to move on to item 15 on the, or sorry, our next request, or?
Not at all. I don't know how long it'll take. The CFO will allow, the CAO will allow the CFO to respond. Mm-hmm.
Just to follow up on this matter, although it's been 10 days, there has been an email sent to the requesting counselor that the information would be provided during the budget deliberations, particularly through the administrative budget deliberations, which we haven't got to yet. Our last budget meeting, I did ask councillors to have some patience as we are really digging in on our current budget. This sundry account does not impact any part of this current budget. This is just an account detail, and it is a sundry account, which essentially is a miscellaneous account. Doesn't impact current budget deliberations, doesn't impact the current budget. It is for the current budget year, and so the planning for the future budget that we're currently discussing is what is consuming all of our time at this point in time. I understand councillors would like information expeditiously, but I thought I've explained it through emails that we are deeply involved in the current 2019-2020 budgeting. I'm also aware that we've responded to council indicating that the details of that budget can be addressed at the upcoming audit committee meeting, which is the appropriate place for that topic. The importance of that is when we disclose accounts and details of accounts, it's very important that councillors get the full picture of all of the booked entries. Otherwise, they will make undue assumptions. So it's very important that you have very factual information. So I was under the impression after sending that email that we would discuss that in depth at the audit committee, which is the proper place for it. I took the liberty of checking with our municipal affairs folks in Halifax just to confirm if that's the right road to go. And they have confirmed that, yes, that's the right process to follow, to take it to the audit committee. So to all of a sudden this evening just say, well, we want it right now, I think it's very, very prudent upon this council to follow a process. And there'd be full disclosure at an audit committee. So I think that's all I have to say on the matter. I mean, this is pretty basic administrative information that can be dealt with a proper process. So that's where I am.
Okay, and we did have a discussion about going through that process, but maybe some more comments. Okay.
Thank you, Warden. Kent, you're, maybe I'm misunderstanding your emails, but your email involving municipal affairs, that you went to municipal affairs, and the proper process was for the 8 months of invoice requests that councillors have been sending you. That's what you're saying is a proper process to bring that to audit. I do want to make a motion on that as well after this, but I thought I was very clear. The item that we're speaking of here has nothing to do with future budgets. It has all to do with current year fiscal budget. At our March 11th meeting, as Councillor Martel mentioned, the public came up and asked about a $3,500 expenditure, of which, and I think they directed the question at Councillor Martel. And it was nice to see that Councillor Martel had looked at our budget and knew we didn't have money for such an expense. Everything that was budgeted was expended. You came up and answered in all of 5 seconds when I asked, where are you getting it from? You said the sundry. So you shocked me, so I tried to look. Then I asked you, did you check that account? And you said you did, and there was money in it. So after the meeting, I sent an email. You looked at it in the day. It took you 5 seconds to answer. It's 14 days later, and you can't print it for me. But you looked in the day. So I just want to see it. And I think it's incumbent upon council, the biggest policy document we put out is the budget, to manage that. And we don't know where we are. We're in March. We have not had a budget to expense meeting at all. I've tried to ask about invoices. I've gotten no response. You say the proper process for that is the budget or the audit committee. First time I hear of it. So this meeting, I'm fully supporting, or this motion, I'm fully supporting this motion, and I do want to see this. I don't know how long it's going to take, but will you allow the CFO to answer that or go and do it? That's all I'm asking. Maybe this takes an hour to do. I don't want to wait around an hour after the meeting, but... Any more discussion? Question?
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I'm disappointed. I don't think my role here as a councillor is to deal with administrative duties. I think we have a staff that's responsible to administer the affairs of Richmond County as far as the operation. When it comes to budget, we have our budget. It's going to be submitted before a council. We got to deal with that. We have an auditing firm. We have audits that are registered with the province of Nova Scotia that are experts in this field. And don't ask me what sundry means or what it doesn't mean. But I know when you have a budget, if there are items that are not budgeted for and you have an excess, I would assume that this is a sundry item. There are some times in Richmond Council, in the municipality, that there are going to be some items that come up or something that comes up before council that we haven't budgeted for. Does that mean we say no, it's not a budgeted item? And any time that I make a motion, if I make a motion to expend $25,000, my responsibility and my duty as a councillor representing the taxpayers in Richmond County is to ask the people in charge of administering these funds, which is our CAO and our chief financial officer, do we have the funds available? And that was the question that was asked. Before I make a motion, second it, or do anything, I ask the question, do we have these funds available? And when you have an account, a budgeted account, we had the auditors that went through our system, and I believe that they're experts, and they can tell me whether or not this is a legal thing to that we operate with. If there was no such thing as sundry being allowed in municipal government, Richmond County, the auditors would have come here and said, listen, this is not the way you operate your municipal government. It's not my job as a councillor. We have our staff. We have a very respected and somebody that's qualified is a chief financial officer and a CAO that deal with these aspects. I'm here to make sure that I trust these people, and if I don't have trust in my staff, I cannot, and I cannot perform my duties as a counselor. And I think we need that. And this motion here, I will not support, and I don't think it's a legal motion. I don't think we can do it. And I think the CAO, according to Department of Municipal Affairs, if you have checked with them, I think you have all the rights not to submit these requests if it's not within the legal aspect of Richmond Municipal Council. And this has gone too far. I'm tired of these aspects that we've got to deal with every little thing. We're in the budget process. Let's move along as Richmond County Council and do the right thing.
Councilor Martel?
Yes. I guess what I want to give a little bit of background, I guess. In 2016, when we ran the election, it was a little bit of a financial crunch here. And the election was ran by all councillors on open and transparency. Now, how can we be open and transparent when we can't, when councillors, not the public, but councillors themselves, the governing body of the council, cannot get information from the CAO? I have a problem with that. And the reason I brought this motion to council tonight is because, obviously, it's not allowed to have one councillor ask for the information, but I'm hoping with a motion of council that we will get that information. And that, for me, I think that we need to know what we need to know. If we need information on finances, we need to look at it. And we need to discuss it with the chief financial officer and the CAO at some point, but we need that information. So we're asking for information. I don't think we should be put off, and because it's budget, the county's not going to stop operating. There's been budgets before. So if we're asking for something from a council perspective, collectively, I expect to get it. Thank you.
Yeah, and I will respond by saying that I do know that, like, it was stated that there was a request for information that was not provided. So I also know that I did read an email saying that if that counselor wanted access to that information, that they could come to the office and sit with the CAO, and the CAO was going to go through that information with that counselor. So when the request to actually have a physical copy of the information came from the counselor, the CAO had spoke to Municipal Affairs, and there was it was advised that this be brought to the audit committee. Now, we have an audit committee scheduled for early April. I believe that that's the due process and the proper process, and I do believe that this motion is out of order.
Mr. Chair, can I speak?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I'm going to read the response by our CAO, and he says he sent me this on Friday at 4:25 p.m., Friday, March the 20th, and he says this: Counselor, your recent request for copies of invoices has resulted in our difference of opinion as to how this should occur. I have spoken with Department of Municipal Affairs, and I want to stress your recent request for copies of invoices. Invoices, not this. Not the sundry account. I have spoken with Department of Municipal Affairs, and the proper avenue to deal with this is through the Audit Committee. I have spoken with the Warden, who is the Chair of the Audit Committee, and he has agreed to have this matter as part of the next Audit Committee. We have had Audit Committees since my 10 years on Council, and I don't ever remember bringing up invoices there. But I do remember in my 10 years of being on Council, it's always been an issue. And it's been an issue with certain invoices. Others that I asked for, the CAO was very quick to respond to others. Those were test invoices. So if he can respond to those, why can he not respond to the ones that I do send that I really want? That's a problem with me. It's also a problem that Municipal Affairs makes a statement that the proper way is the Audit Committee. I should be able to look at this at any time of the month or year. That's a problem. So I will be supporting this motion,
And after that motion, I would like to make another motion with the comments that have come up.
Motion is out of order.
I will challenge the chair on that, and that will go to the floor as for if this motion is out of order. I'll need a second.
It's been discussed.
We can challenge it.
It's been discussed. We have a process in place where we are going to get the information that you requested.
Mr. Chair, with all due respect, we spent thousands and thousands of dollars on a strategic plan, and we speak of communication and transparency. This is one simple little thing. And if people's antennas aren't getting higher and higher and higher with this for one small little sundry account, just want to know what's in it. That's all.
And we have a date and we have time.
No. I know nothing about this coming up at an audit committee. This email says nothing about sundry. This is new. And I'm very, very disappointed. And this motion to me is not out of order in any way. Not out of order. We direct our CAO through policy and through motions. That's what we do. And there's a motion here on the floor this evening. And I don't believe you have the ability to say this is out of order. Give us the grounds that it is out of order.
It's out of order because there's an avenue in place for you to receive the information that you asked for. Now, just because you're not going to get it tonight doesn't mean that you're not going to get it. So if we have a process that's put in place that we've already discussed with regards to making sure that you and any other counselor is going to receive the information that they've requested, that would be a different story. That process is in place. I'm not sure if the meeting has an actual date yet, but the email did go out to request that meeting for the audit committee to specifically deal with those items that counselors want to have access to.
That said nothing about the sundry account. I can't believe what's happening here. And to call a motion out of order, under what grounds are you doing that?
I just explained the grounds that I have. Do we have a process in place?
So where's the process? Is it in our bylaws? Is it in the MGA? At any point, Section 30 of the MGA states that a counselor can speak to their staff, the CAO, or to his staff to ask for information. Does it specify what information I can or can't ask for?
Because
this has been an issue with these checks, invoices for these checks.
Okay,
I
have ruled this out of order.
And I am challenging that, and that should go to the floor.
No.
Yes, it does.
No.
Well, we have somebody here from Municipal Affairs. Allow them to speak.
Ron, can you provide?
I can't.
Not sure. Okay. Thank you. Okay, so if I'm wrong on this, then I'm wrong on this, and everyone will receive my apology on that. But until that happens, this motion is out of order.
Well, I think if a motion is challenged and there's a seconder for that challenge, the floor will decide if that motion doesn't go forward.
I don't think so. I don't think you need legal advice on this, and until you get legal advice from our solicitor, I don't think you should go to the floor tonight. You declared it illegal. That means you need legal advice, and we have legal opinion. We have our solicitor ask them to question and we'll be with it.
Okay, that's a good point. We will seek some legal advice on that. And again,
can I read something in this Rivera's Rules of Order book? And it's enforcing points of order and appeals. If the chair of the meeting acts improperly, for example, fails to recognize a member entitled to speak on the floor or ignores a motion properly made and seconded that is not dilatory, you got to see Section 39. And neither states the question on the motion nor rules.
I'm going to repeat myself for one more time. I have declared it out of order. Now, if I have made a mistake on that after speaking to legal, then I will certainly apologize to everybody on that. Until then, we have a process in place where we are going to deal with this, and that is when and where we're going to deal with this.
This is shocking. Shocking.
Just to let you know how many times this request is going to be blocked by either yourself or CAO.
I'm not trying to block anything.
Obviously you are.
No, I'm not.
Because we're making a motion on something different, just that we need a computer generated. I mean, we have the checks every month. How long does it take with the technology today to push a button and get a generated list.
Well,
is there a problem with us having the list?
Well,
that's my problem.
We have.
I just want to know how many times we're going to block it.
Well, I'm not blocking
it. Another week.
We set up something for us to get access to that information, and it's set up. So if we don't get access to the information that we're asking for on that night of that meeting, following the advice of municipal affairs, then that's a different story.
Let me tell you another thing about municipal affairs. The gentleman from municipal affairs, I'm not really remember what his name is, but I remember sitting at a meeting here on governance. And you know what we were told about the system here? It's not municipal affairs that runs our county. It's this municipal council.
Right.
And what we decide goes.
Yeah.
That's the difference. Municipal affairs, sure. If we're against the MGA, very fine. We're not supposed to do that. But on a day-to-day basis, council reads collectively runs the county, not municipal affairs.
I think that you're sort of misinterpreting my intention here, because we spoke of the intention. And we said that we would set up an audit committee meeting specifically to get the information that councillors requested.
Yeah, sure.
Well, Councillor Martel, you were there, and you were fine with it that night. But something has changed between now and then, and I don't know what that is.
I was fine with that night because we were talking about giving out...
invoices.
Invoices.
Only
not sundry
invoices.
Account. And I told you that night that I was sitting with you that I was going to ask for this at the meeting, didn't I?
You were told.
Did I ask you that
together
night?
With some kind of motion, and I have no idea what that motion was going to be.
I asked you that night that I told you I was going to go home and I was going to write an email, and Adams added, to ask for this information.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So I had no idea what your motion was going to be.
Well, I told you it was going to be about getting the information.
Right.
That's what I told you.
Yeah.
And we agreed to that.
Yeah.
That was a way to go. Use the proper procedure, and I did. A motion of council, collectively. That's a democratic process. Right? So anyways, it's your
call. Yep. Okay.
No, I don't believe it's your call, but...
Well, if I'm wrong, like I said, we'll deal with me if and when I'm wrong, then we'll deal with me at that point in time. I don't have any issues with that.
Thank you, Warden. First of all, I'm going to support the motion, and I wanted to record it.
Support what motion?
The motion was made, and it was seconded by Councillor Martel.
Motion was denied by the...
I don't care if the motion was denied. I'm telling
wasn't
you right
accepted.
Now I'm supporting the motion, and I want it recorded.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Okay. Next item on the agenda, the ATV trail discussion. Deputy Warden?
Yeah. Guess I'm a little shocked by what just transpired. The St. Peter's railway bed. Seems to be a lot of discussion about that over the years, who owns it, who doesn't own it. And what I want to do is have a motion that staff speak with the Crown, who's one of the owners, or is the owner, and DNR, and have them come to this to meet the five councillors so we can have a discussion on it. We want to know who has the final say, because some groups think they control it. And that no ATVers or it's not a multi-purpose trail. So my motion is to have staff bring DNR and the Crown to speak to us here so we can find out exactly what the status is and if there's anything we can do about that.
Okay, there's a motion on the floor for the ATV rail bed, or sorry, the rail bed in St. Peter's. Okay, from River Tiller to St. Peter's, be discussed with DNR so that they can come in and just provide accurate information?
Correct.
Okay. Seconded by Councillor Boucher.
Well, the Crown supposedly is the owner of this said property, and I do have a PID number, 75137471. That makes any difference, but can't say for sure. It's the proper one, but it is the trail from St. Peter's, from River Tillard right into St. Peter's.
Okay.
We need some discussion with the proper people that have the final say. If it's up to the minister, let's have that person here.
Okay. And moved by Deputy Warden and seconded by Councillor Boucher. Discussion on the motion?
Question.
Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried.
Thank you, Warden.
Okay.
Right. So we will move on to item 15 on the agenda. We do have a 15-minute question period. Anybody wants to approach council, please do so at the back, and I will ask that we stick to agenda items, please, and thank you. It's 8:16 now, so 8:30, or 8:31, sorry. Yep, okay.
Hi
there.
Jermaine McDonald from St. Peter's.
Yep.
And
Okay.
Okay. And it's sad to say that tonight I'm feeling like deja vu. We've been told on countless occasions by municipal affairs since 2000 and probably 12 that they do not get involved in operations at the municipal level. They also said that their MGA is a guideline. That's it. And as we've seen, I think, everyone, they've never been able to enforce anything, because if they did, we'd never have had to go through what we did, the staff did, and whatnot from 2000, probably 14, 15. So to sit here tonight and to listen to this conversation and to have, well, an ask of municipal affairs to get up and give an answer, and they can't, but they could when the CAO contacted them, and for our councillors who we elect and expect are going to ask questions, if they can't get them, that's the exact kind of issues that came up for all those years that made the fuss about everything and ended up in a forensic audit. Now, the CAO this evening said that the information for the sundry account was basic. Basic to me means CFO goes into the computer and he prints off the sundry account. It's in an accounting software program, likely. And so when I'm sitting here and listening that three counselors, at least out of five, only want to see what's in that one account and can get it by a printout, I think I'm getting scared again. That, you know, because for me, if there's nothing wrong with what they're asking for, there's no reason not to give it. And the councillors are bound by confidentiality, so they're not supposed to be going out to the public and giving that information. But I certainly expect as a taxpayer that when they go to their staff being the CAO, and ask a question or ask for information, that it's going to be provided. And if it's basic, not even 10 days wouldn't be acceptable to myself as an employer. And so if I wouldn't have heard what I heard tonight, I would probably not feel that, but some of the comments that were made here tonight, I'm sorry, but it gives cause for concern at a taxpayer level that I hope we're not going to spiral down that same road of issues where we're getting municipal affairs, giving information to your staff or your councillors and the public. And again, I reiterate, I've always been told, and so have others, that municipal affairs do not get involved in operations. So I'm actually kind of surprised that you guys are saying tonight that they told you this is the proper procedure and that's what you're going to follow, because that was the problem before. It's whose interpretation of the act, whose interpretation do you go with at the taxpayer level or at the council level? So I just want to voice my concern, and I'm sorry. These gentlemen who are asking for information tonight should be provided that information, and I also don't think that this was out of order, but again, I guess, you know, we'll eventually see that as well.
Yep.
But again, as a taxpayer, I have a concern when we have this type of communication around the council table.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Barry Landry. A lot of you people know me. I've been involved in municipal politics here for a little bit, and involved in the last election, and I just want to remind Warden McLean what he was elected on about being transparent and being open, and very disappointed. I have been away here since a little bit, but to come here and see what I see here tonight from you and the CAO, for a simple account with everything we went through here in the last few months. You guys should be ashamed of yourself.
Well, with all due respect, Barry, you have no idea how conversations have gone here. So to sit there and judge my character is not appropriate at all.
Well, I'm judging your character.
You are judging me by what you see here tonight. And I'm going to tell you, there's information that you do not know about, that you should not know about. There's conversations that you do not know about. So we have a process in place, and I will tell you right now that if we do not get the answers that we're looking for when we meet with the meeting that we have set up, then I'm going to have great concerns with that. But there's a process that needs to take place, and the process is in motion.
Warden McLean, you're forgetting what happened here in the last 6-7 years.
I don't think that I am.
You fought against that. I was with you. You fought against that.
Yep.
And here you are defending that.
Defending what?
You should be ashamed of yourself.
What am I defending?
Hi, I'm Lisa Boudreau. I just wanted to just make a comment this evening that the request for grant proposals, if it's possible, in the light of transparency, I would like to have all grant proposals listed, all grant approved proposals, and all grant proposals that have been requested and not approved with a reason as to why. Because what we get when we come to these meetings are a list of approved grants, but we don't see all the grants that were requested that are not approved. And in our case, and I know it's not part of the discussion this evening, but I believe this is where this whole sundry comes from, I did send an email to the CFO, Jason Martell, to request some information on our particular ask, and also to talk about the issues of that ask and how they would be funded in the future. So I think that in light of everything that's going on here this evening, yes, I was here when there was a question about sundry. I also had a response from Councillor Martell to say that there was no money in the budget for our request, and that's why it didn't even get to discussion at the meeting. And I received an email, well, actually, I did not receive an email from Jason, but I did receive an email that was referred to him from Pierre La Rochelle that stated that he could not pass our ask to the next meeting because it had been dealt with at the previous one. In my mind, I truly disagree with that because it had not been dealt. What we had was absolute silence on the motion, which is one of the most disheartening responses to receive for someone who puts, and for all community groups who put their heart and soul and their own personal expense into endeavors that they believe in. We do not have a tourism or an economic development direct within this municipal staff, and it's something that I feel is a void in at this level, and it's very, very easy for people to say the money is there or not there. And I think if we had a committed budget within our own council, then maybe it would be easier for staff and the councillors to actually deal with that. But to say at a meeting that the money is there or the money is not there is difficult for the groups that are waiting on these types of funds to see their asks happen. So as it turns out, There is a fair amount of generosity in this community, as it always has been, and our ask will be funded, and we will attend the event this year, the Saltscapes event this year. But I asked in the email, going forward, because it is part of the strategic plan that's just been recently passed, and that it actually is an item in there as being a best practice, how are the municipal staff supposed to meet that mandate that was supported by council if we can't even get any responses on requests of a tourism type nature? So that's my question. I asked Jason in the email to respond to it. I ask that you take some time and think about that so that he can make an appropriate response.
Yep.
And I think I asked that on behalf of the four groups that put
it forward. And I know that for this one, maybe just because there was the one ask from one person from one of the groups, that we didn't reach out to all of the groups. So that's something to that we should have done. So, yes, thank you.
It was an erroneous submission that the council were voting on, and it should not have been left out of the of a discussion a second time.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
We do have time for one more question.
Good evening, Ellen Poligato. This question is to everyone. I'm wondering how much discussion on item 14A and B took place prior to it being put on the agenda?
I don't believe there was any discussion on it whatsoever. There was a request that was filled out by, they were the same counselor who filled out the request to have something added to the items added to the agenda that was submitted to the clerk and the CAO.
Okay. Okay, the reason why I asked that question is, I think most of us know that the role of a CAO in part is to manage and administer the affairs of the municipality and put in place staff to carry out the public services. And it surprises me that an agenda item or those two agenda items can come onto the agenda without prior discussion with the CAO. I think it undermines the system that is in place. I don't know if someone would like to respond to that. It just seems unusual, and particularly since we had three councillors who voted to give notice of suspension or termination, not sure if I'm using the correct words there, of services without any analysis, without any discussion. That's worrisome. I'm not sure where the three councillors' heads or what your thinking is, and I would love to hear your response for that.
Deputy, did you want to respond to that?
I'll make some statements. Thank you, Warden. I want to begin by reading the email that started some of the discussion this evening, not pertaining to yours, but pertaining to the previous gentleman first. After the meeting, I sent an email, and it was sent twice and once to the warden. And I asked, Kent, you brought up a sundry account this evening that had some funds remaining. Could you let me know how much that budgeted item is and an itemized list of what was paid from that account? That got sent twice within the next 3 days to the warden on Thursday. Simple. There's no more discussion. The answer to your question about how much discussion has happened, I think you saw it this evening. How much discussion can we have with the CAO? We ask for information, we don't get it. We get what he wants us to get. So if we'd have brought up these items, maybe he would have decided not to talk to us about them, not to put them on the agenda. Who knows? We've been asking for information for 8 months, and we're not getting it. It's roadblock after roadblock after roadblock. And as one of the previous presenters said, deja vu, it's all over again. When information is being withheld that I can't come to a meeting, because I believe one of the emails the warden spoke about said that in reference to my email on sundry, he mentioned, well, we can give you some invoices at the budget meeting, and I think that was last Thursday. Well, I said, print them off for me. I never got them, because Friday an email came that was another process of getting them. So if Friday he spoke of municipal affairs stating there was a proper procedure was going through the audit, he had no intention of giving them to me on Thursday evening anyway. It wasn't the fact that I asked and needed them in paper. I wanted a copy of them. I didn't just want to look at them and walk away. I wanted a copy. So that initiated municipal affairs. And it brings it all back to 2013, 12, 13, 14, 15, all of that. If I cannot have information, you expect that I should speak to the CAO?
14A and B on the agenda are EDPC and
rent. My point is, we are having a hard time maybe getting information from the CAO, so we need to make decisions here. We're $700,000-$800,000 short this year. It's a tax increase, or we got to start looking at things.
I'll just do a closing question then. For the three councillors that voted to support the motions on those two items, which is, were any attempts made to have discussion with a committee or with the CAO in regards to those two items? Okay, so I'll leave it there and just close by saying that I think there's an undermining of the natural roles of a CAO and the role of the council. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we are going in camera, and we should come out with a motion tonight. So, moved by Councillor Boucher to go in camera, seconded by Councillor Martel.
Yes, I move that council accept the recommendation of the revenue manager and CFO, and that council authorize the revenue manager and CFO to determine a minimum acceptable bid on the four noted properties. And if these properties do not sell for the minimum acceptable bid, to proceed and sell the properties for any bid. I so move.
It's not.
Okay. Councillor Boucher, that the council accept the recommendation of the revenue manager and CFO, and that council authorize the revenue manager and CFO to determine a minimum acceptable bid on the four noted properties, and if these properties do not sell for the minimum acceptable bid, to proceed and sell the properties for any bid. Any discussion on the motion? Question's been called. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Motion carried. Move to adjourn. Councillor Boucher, seconded by Councillor Martel. Thank you.